Hi, thank you for tuning in. My name is Dr. Amber Bryant, and I'm a project manager at the Institute for Social Research at the University of Michigan. More specifically, I work for the Inter-university Consortium for Political and Social Research, ICPSR, on the Peers Data Hub team, the Partnerships for Expanding Education Research in STEM. Today, we are speaking with Dr. Ebony McGee about her newest book, Black, Brown, Bruised: How Racialized STEM Education Stifles Innovation. Dr. McGee is an Associate Professor of Diversity and STEM Education at Vanderbilt University's Peabody College. She investigates the racialized experiences and social, material, and health costs that adversely affect the education and career trajectories of underrepresented groups of color. With funding from six NSF grants, Dr. McGee has co-founded the Explorations and Diversifying Engineering Faculty Initiative and the Institute in Critical, Quantitative, and Mixed Methodologies Training for Underrepresented Scholars. Her first solo authored book is entitled Black, Brown, Bruised: How Racialized STEM Education Stifles Innovation, which became available this month, October 2020, and is the focus of our conversation today. Dr. McGee, thank you so much for joining us. If it's okay with you, I'm going to jump right in with our questions.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
Yes, it's a privilege. Okay, so can you tell us a little bit about your book and your inspiration behind writing it?
Sure. I want to just first say that I am a little labored with my speech because I'm getting over a cold, but it is not COVID-19, so I'm very happy about that. What I really wanted to do was to understand successful STEM underrepresented students of color, because I really wanted to live a happy life where I just told these beautiful stories of folks being really resilient in a field that really doesn't claim them. You know, they love STEM, but STEM really doesn't love them back. And I just thought I'd have a very cheerful and successful time with that. But what I failed to realize is that you can be successful in STEM, yet still very marginalized. Marginalized to the point that it even leads to mental and physical health difficulties. It does disrupt STEM trajectories. It results in all kinds of stress, imposter syndrome, depression, and other problems. So opposed to me thinking that this was going to be a very happy-go-lucky tale of success and resilience, and certainly to some extent it is, but it also talks about STEM being individualistic, ultra-competitive, lily white with some tokenized Asians, mostly heterosexual, militaristically grounded, middle to upper class, nationalist, and able-bodied. I could probably put five more in there, and what that does to underrepresented people of color who have historically largely been marginalized out of the STEM ecosystem. So what I came to realize through my interviews is that those who make it through, those who we put on our posters and celebrate their successes, they also harbor bruises. What it means to be academically successful STEMmer of color, where so few are in these fields, and how they bear the burden of negative beliefs about their ability, about their motivations. And I found myself switching the question from how they're so resilient to how do they manage to survive these brutal academic climates, and what does it cost?
Wow, that was amazing. I did not, I did not expect that. As awesome to hear. So I look forward to talking more about that. So the next question I have for you, it's a little specific about the book. I noticed that it highlights qualitative narratives from underrepresented students and faculty members in the fields of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Can you tell us a little bit about the data you collected and used for the book?
Absolutely. So the book started from my dissertation research, in 2009. I used a phenomenological approach, try to say that fast five times, which is an appropriate approach when the goal is to understand the perspectives of the research participants. It also helped me paint high achieving STEM students of color into existence. Because when I told people that I wanted to do a dissertation in my career on high achieving Black students of color in STEM, people asked me, where are you gonna find them? And I graduated from an HBCU, North Carolina A&T State University, Aggie Pride, with hundreds of scientists, computer scientists, technology folks, engineers. So how are you gonna tell us we don't exist? And why can't you find us? We're not hiding, we're right here. So I really wanted to rely on in-depth interviews to investigate that kind of insider perspective and to develop a composite description of these folks of color in this particular phenomenon. I also use multiple case study analysis, really following several students through the course of several years of their STEM learning and participation, which was really helpful to understand complex phenomena and how racism and race sexism manifests in students of color and how they respond to them.
Gotcha. It's powerful. Your book offers suggestions for policies and practices to support the structural changes aimed at minimizing these harmful and negative effects of non-inclusive practices in academia. Can you give us your top three recommendations that you want to make sure we take away from the reading?
So I saw this question and I'm really hesitant to give you, if you just follow these six things, it will lead to structural change, because that is what we should be arguing for, not a piecemeal solution, not, you know, with an all deliberate time. We should really be arguing for structural change and structural change right now. So with that, let me be very clear in saying the entirety of STEM higher education and STEM employment needs to be dismantled, like period. The foundation of STEM was STEM in the university in the 1950s and 1960s. My grandmother and your grandmother could not walk inside of many restaurants in the South. You know, this was the development of STEM was the development in the phase of Jim Crow. So the foundation needs to be broke and rebuilt. And it needs to be rebuilt with STEM people of color within and beyond STEM, because it's not just about the STEM, it's about the psychology, it's about the sociology, it's about the culture, it's about the education. So folks within and beyond STEM need to lead the effort, and the whole system, the whole ecosystems needs to be redesigned to be more equitable and inclusive with the goals of celebrating racial diversity and innovation in STEM. And when I mean innovation, I mean like innovation has been stunted for the last 50 years. Don't take my word, these are what the white economists are saying. So when I was a little girl and I thought that when I became where I am right now, that I would be flying in my car, it wasn't a dream. It's not a myth. Our STEM innovation is actually stunted because we are not using the full strength, culture, magnitude of the population that exists. So I'm just going to lay that out, but I know everybody is not ready for the revolution. So they are some kind of do nows. The first thing that I think that needs to happen in STEM is that there needs to be a deep appreciation of what Black, Latinx, and Indigenous cultures can offer STEM disciplines. You know, particularly when we're fighting things like environmental justice, like how can we fight environmental racism and environmental causes that are basically like burning us alive, like the planet is burning and melting simultaneously. How can you do that without thinking about Indigenous folks? and their long history of honoring and respecting the earth. Like, why? I mean, we are killing ourselves by not understanding how our cultures, the cultures of people of color, can actually help save the planet, right? And there's a sordid history of folks of color, our intellectuals, being left out of the STEM enterprise. And even if you go back to our Black historians like Carter G. Woodson, you know, he says, even in the certitude of science and mathematics, it is unfortunate that the approach to the Negro has been borrowed from a foreign, and I say Eurocentric method, right? So we know, we have 50 years of data saying that this Eurocentric method is not leading to the type of innovations that we should have, and that we're behind the times, right? So having folks of color in places and spaces where they can add to the innovation and not make you redo your products because your products can't recognize Black skin, right? I mean, you know, even if people don't believe diversity is good for diversity's sake, at least just have somebody in the room who, you know, has different types of skin color so you don't have to redo your product, right? So that's one thing we need to do. The other thing, and I'm just going to give two because, you know, you have to read the book to get all of them, is that we, as people of color, we don't own an airline company. We don't have a rental car company, an automobile company. We don't own anything in big tech, like the Googles, the Microsoft. Why is that? Why don't we have a percentage in this STEM innovation? Why aren't we the leaders? Why is the goal of people of color to work for the Google instead of being the next Google, right? And then we have the policies of the presidential administration, you know, very anti-science, and a 400-year history and mistreatment of devalued knowledge and devalued STEM. So what I'm saying is STEM is worse because we are not in STEM. So what do we need to do? We need to get some reparations. Yes, I said it. And we need to have our own enterprises, right? We need to stop begging the Microsofts and the Googles of the world, who are barely in the single digit percentiles of Black and Latinx folks as STEM employers, STEM employees. And we need to ask them to break off a chunk of their billions and let us build our own thing. And letting us build our own thing would actually enrich and provide healthy competition for these businesses that are white, male, and Eurocentric, right? Because they're missing out on so much innovation by not having the brilliant minds, bodies, and souls of people of color.
Yes, I completely agree with you. And the first thing that came to my mind when you mentioned us not owning large corporations in the tech field, in the tech space, was the disenfranchisement of generations of people of color. And, you know, just those different access barriers and access points where we didn't have the social capital or the financial capital or, you know, the means to education, you know, access to the education, and kind of just kind of held us back in those spaces. And reparations is one of the only ways to really rectify the long history of that type of disenfranchisement. So,
right. Because many of these companies that are here today come from a history, a family history of folks being able to go to college, major in engineering. It's not just they opened up the universities to people of color. It's when did they open us up to the STEMs, right? Because we were able to be electricians, but not electrical engineers. We're able to be sound technicians, but not sound engineers, right? So there's a sordid history of folks of color really being shut out of the STEM enterprise. And now that we get a little piece of the puzzle, and that's even been declining over the last few years, you know, you just want us to start from there and build these enterprises. No, we need some reparations for that.
Yeah, absolutely. Awesome. Great point. So it's my last question for you today. Who was this book written for, your intended audience? And how do you hope this book is used now and in the future?
You know, this book was written for, first of all, the students who I interviewed. So I made a pledge to them, not just the students. I interviewed faculty. I interviewed university staff, like engineering program directors, who are fabulous. They keep the whole thing running. They are actually retention makers. They are the reason why some Black students stay in STEM. So I can't say enough about the university staff who engages in STEM. But I told them that I would honor and honestly tell their stories. So I felt like I had a responsibility to do that, and to do that in a way that could sound the alarm by saying, success is not problem-free, particularly in a hostile culture like STEM. So although we are given these folks of colors awards, they're on the covers of our university website, news press, diversity awards, they are still hurting, they are still suffering. And guess what? It is not their fault. You know, they're being as resilient as they possibly can, but resilience without proper external forms of support is just another way of oppressing people. And my argument is that these high achieving students and faculty and people of color are disproportionately leaving STEM, disproportionately to their white counterparts, not because of the STEM. It's not because of their lack of ability or lack of intelligence, but God dog, I have the PhD in STEM, in nuclear engineering, and people are still questioning my ability, my worth, and I'm gonna have to live the rest of my life like this? Are you kidding? No, I'm moving over to a discipline that respects and protects my intellectual identity. So what that means is we are losing a population of STEM folks who could be on the cutting edge of innovation because the culture doesn't love us, right? Mm. And that's a structural problem. So I'm also writing for these white folks who say they can't find us, who claim we don't exist. And what that really means is that we don't fit your definition of success, right? And letting you know that not only are we here, but just bringing us in the door is not enough. You got to create a space and a place for us to thrive, not simply survive.
Dr. McGee, I cannot thank you enough. Thank you so much for your words of wisdom. And as a young scholar myself, African-American female, you know, hearing these things is so validating as I enter this field, you know, personally. So I appreciate it deeply hearing from you. And listeners, you can purchase the book on Harvard Education Press, as well as through Amazon, Black, Brown, Bruised, How Racialized STEM Education Stifles Innovation. And you can also follow Dr. McGee and her work at blackengineeringphd.org and at Relationship Gaps on Twitter. So thank you all again. Thank you, Dr. McGee, as well as my listeners. And until next time. So thank you.
Thank you, Amber. Thanks so much for having me. And I appreciate you, sis. I just want to let you know I'm so proud of you and the direction and where you're going. But we also need to understand that the PhD does not save us. Mm. So I need you to make sure to get your racial battle armor on, because, you know, this academic space ain't no joke. If you need me, be sure to reach out. I'm here for you.
Absolutely. Oh, I love you already. Thank you so much. We'll talk again.
Okay. All right. Yes.